And we are live. István, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Chris. So welcome, everybody, on the 37th Data Science Leuven Meetup, also known as the Murphy Edition, because this 37th Meetup has been quite unfortunate. Not only did we have to cancel the previous or the original date that we had foreseen because of technical issues at my side, today we have to cancel our guest from the University of Connecticut because he had connection problems. That's what happens when you work for the University of Connecticut, of course. But that's not a problem because we have Chris Peters who will replace Emil.
And Chris Peters. I will do my best, right?
Yeah, we and obviously you know Chris Peters because he's one of the co-organizers. He's from Data Minded, and he will give a talk, and the title of that talk will be the Data Engineering Manifesto. And then the second speaker for this evening will be Tim Hellemans. From the Department of Computer Science of the University of Antwerp, and he will talk about discrete optimization, large optimization problems with little data. So originally, I had foreseen to welcome some of the students of the University of Connecticut of one of Emil's courses because they were supposed to follow this session as well, plus some students from the University of Antwerp, those from who were interested in that talk as well. But I guess that they will not be here tonight. We'll see. So normally I wanted to tell them a little bit about the University of Leuven, but I guess we will keep that for the next occasion because I hope that we will somehow be able to get Emil at some later date. So here is the usual contact information that you all know by now, but I want to repeat it here in case you have something on your mind, you have an interesting topic that you would like to share on Data Science Leuven, then you can always contact one of the people here and then we see whether we can schedule that in. So one of the good things that Data Science Leuven, the 37th Data Science Leuven meetup was postponed is that the time between the 37th and the 38th is only a little bit more than a week. So Friday, the 4th of June, we already have the 38th Data Science Leuven meetup.
And let's hope, fingers crossed, that the 39th meetup, which we do in September, because we don't have meetups during the summer, that in September we can host the meetups back at Stuk in Leuven. We already tried to book the room and book the auditorium. Well, Tim Verdonk, but apparently Stuk decided to completely redecorate and renovate the auditorium like right after being closed for 2 years. Then they decide to renovate. So we have booked some auditoriums in the area, but let's of course wait and see what the policies are, the official policies. But we have good hopes that the next meetup, like the 39th meetup, will be in Leuven again. Maybe with a if we can get that to work with a streaming session as well, like that you can follow it on YouTube as well. But we still need to figure out the practicalities of that. But so the good news is that hopefully, as of the 39th meetup, we can see each other in person again.
That is indeed great. Great news. And with that, I propose that we go over to Tim Hellemans, University of Antwerp, who will talk about optimization. Tim, it's all yours.
Yes. Okay. Thanks for introducing me and having me for this talk and this meetup. So the topic I will be discussing in the coming more or less 20 minutes is on discrete optimization. And I call these large optimization problems with little data, as these optimization problems are typically it's typical that in these optimization problems, you only need a small amount of data to get a very complex optimization problem. So this is not like most optimization problems in machine learning and deep learning or whatever, where you have a lot of data to do your optimization. You only have a small amount of data for these discrete optimization problems. And the choices you have to make here are always discrete choices. So to get a feel of the type of optimization problems I mean, I will give a couple of examples. So first, in the airline industry, there are a lot of examples, but one example which I will be discussing in more detail in this presentation is the tail assignment problem. And here you get a schedule. Well, you get the airline will tell you, I want to have these flights in the next 2 weeks to be executed. And you have to decide when to schedule each of these flights. These are discrete choices because you either schedule this flight on that date or you don't. So that makes it a discrete optimization problem. And then what you want to minimize is the crew cost and the fuel cost for the airplanes to fly those distances. Another typical example is creating a work schedule. And the most typical one in that area is the nurse scheduling problem. So there you have a hospital, and in that hospital, there always have to be nurses and doctors which are on duty day and night. But there are a lot of constraints because, of course, you can't let a nurse work all night and then the next day all day and so on. There are a lot of restrictions on which type of schedules you can give to each of the nurses and each of the doctors. And again, it's discrete because you, for each slot, you have to decide, do I put this nurse or doctor there or don't I put it there? A more theoretical problem is the vehicle routing problem. So here you have a factory, and from that factory, you want to supply some goods to a set of customers, and you have a couple of trucks at your factory, and they have to drive around. And what you want to do is minimize the total distance traveled while supplying all the goods to all of the customers. And so again, this is discrete because for each route, you have to decide whether you take it or you don't. And another typical example is construction line for cars, where you have to decide in which sequence you will be producing these cars. So it's a car sequencing problem. And the problem here is that each car requires different options, and these different options have to be put on the cars by certain machines. And for example, if you want a moonroof, you can't produce 20 cars which require a moonroof in sequence. So you have to diversify which cars you produce when, such that all machines can keep up with the production at all times. So some of these problems we will discuss in more depth in this presentation. But let's carry on by saying, why do we need to do these type of optimizations? Because for many people, it might seem like, okay, you just take a greedy algorithm and you see how well that goes, right? And as a counterexample, I found this example from a book, The Case Studies in Operations Research by Kataji Murthy, which I quite liked. So here we have a table which is giving us the expected annual profit if we put crew CI on zone ZJ. And these numbers are given in millions of dollars, apparently, but that doesn't really matter too much. But so what one of these numbers means, so for example, this 36, it means that if we put crew C2 on zone Z1, then this will give us $36 million of revenue. And so a manager could say, okay, what will we do? We just look at this table and we pick the highest number. So we take this 36, that's putting crew C2 on zone Z1. That's the best choice we can take at this point because that's giving us the largest profit. So we will do that. And then for the next assignments, we can't use Crew C2 anymore, and we can't use Zone Z1 anymore, because they are both assigned to each other. Then we look for the largest remaining number, which is 25. Then we have used Crew C3 and Zone Z4. Then we select the 16, which is the largest remaining number, 9, 4, and 1. And adding these all together, we get a nice revenue of $91 million. So this is fine. It looks like a good solution because we have always taken the largest possible number in our table. But if we take another solution, for example, just taking the diagonal, putting a crew CI on zone ZI for each I, then we find that the total revenue is already $114 million. So just taking this actually random solution gives us a much better revenue than taking this very specific greedy solution, which felt like a good thing to do. And apparently for this specific example, what is 91 is the minimal possible solution. So this 90, you can't do worse than this 91. So greedy solutions aren't that good in general. And that's something which occurs very frequently in these discrete optimization problems, that if you just do a greedy solution, you can get really, really, really bad solutions. And so this is a nice example of that. And then, well, we would want the optimal solution, right? Because we have this 114, it's better than 91, but we have no idea if it's optimal or not. And so therefore, we give a mathematical model to which models this situation. So we denote this xij, and this xij is a binary variable. It's either 0 or 1. And we will say that it's 1 if we assign crew ci to zone zj. And if we don't assign crew ci to zone zj, then this xij will be 0. Then what we want to do is maximize the total profit. So these aijs are the numbers in this table. And so what we want to do is to maximize the sum of aij times xij, because then we are only summing the values in this table for which we have indeed assigned crew ci to zone zj. Of course, there are restrictions. And what these two restrictions are saying is that for each crew member, we can assign them to at most one zone, and each zone should be assigned to at most one crew member. So those are the two restrictions you have. And then using this model, you can find the optimal solution, which gives us 121, apparently. And so this optimization problem is very, very, very simple because it's so small. And one could argue we could just brute force it, right? How many options are there? We can just enumerate them all. There are 6 factorial options, 720. A computer does this in a fraction of a second, so no problems there. But of course, this n factorial is going to become a very, very large number if n grows large. And we know that in particular, that n factorial is greater than n over 2 to the power n over 2. So for example, if n would be 20, then you already have 10 to the power 10, which is quite a significant complexity. But for that n, if you would use this model, which I have in the bottom left corner, this would still run without any issue, while the brute force method would fail miserably. So therefore, we see that optimization for these type of problems is really a very important thing to do. All right, let's look at a more practical example. So the airline schedule, which I talked about in the first slide. So what we have is we have a schedule. Let's say that we have 14 days. So we have a number of flights which we have to do in a time of 14 days. So in 14 days, we have to do all these flights. We have 28 airports from which we have to fly. And what the data is telling us, that the departure airport, Brussels airport, must go to London Gatwick. The travel time between these two airports is 2 hours. The number of trips in these 14 days, which we require, are 6. And we always have to depart between 6 in the morning and 8 in the evening. And then we have another line, which is telling us that we have to go from Brussels Airport to Atlanta Airport. In this takes 11 hours, four trips, and the departure window is between 6 and 4. And so like this, we have a couple of hundred rows. So this is very small, right? It's not a lot of data, 100 rows times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 columns. So it's like 500 things of data that you have to put in your optimization algorithm, which is small, therefore the title of small data. But the optimization problem which comes from this is very large, as I will show you. So you can take these things which we have in this table, and you can make a graph. So we have Brussels, we have London Gatwick, we have Atlanta, and you have to fly between Brussels and London Gatwick. We have to fly between Brussels and Atlanta, and you have to fly between London Gatwick and Atlanta. But of course, just taking this doesn't really, we can't really model anything on this graph. We have to make this graph time dependent. So the type of edges which we need to have is like saying Brussels Airport, day one, 1 o'clock. From there, we can travel to London Gatwick on day one at 3 o'clock, because we know that the travel time from Brussels to London Gatwick is 2 hours, and therefore we have this edge. All right, so we have this time-dependent graph with these type of edges. And if you would draw out this graph, what it looks like is this pretty big circular blob of points. Each point here represents an airport at a specific date, at a specific hour, and each of these light gray things is telling us that a plane can fly from this edge to this other edge. And it looks a bit like a flower with all these bumps, and each of these bumps is one day. So you have 14 days, and so therefore you have this circular motion over these 14 days. And then a valid path for a plane, so a valid schedule, is then a circular path on this graph. So what we do here is we identify day number 14 with day number 0. So the days are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 until 13. And then day 14, the schedule starts repeating. So therefore, we have edges from day 13 to day 0. And therefore, we have this circular motion in the graph. Okay, we have 28 airports, and now what is the complexity of this thing? We assume that we have 28 airports and we have 12 planes. Then we have this XPE, and what this XPE is telling us is plane P on edge E, right? So this is either 0 or 1, whether or not we assign plane P to edge E. What about complexity? So there are 24 hours in a day. There are 14 days, so that gives you the 24 times 14. There are 28 airports, so there are 28 airports from which we can start our flight, and then each flight can go to another airport. So therefore, we have this 27, because we can fly from the airport to another airport. So that's 28 times 27. And then you have 12 planes, so that's that times 12. So therefore, this optimization problem, which looked like a very small problem with only 500 data points, gives you an optimization problem with 3 million variables, which seems like quite a lot, right? So that's quite a lot to decide whether these have to be 0 or 1. And the type of constraints we have are constraints like saying you have to perform all flights, the planes need to have maintenance, they need to have planes in standby for when another plane fails, and these type of things. And costs you have to consider are things like the crew cost, the fuel cost, and stuff like that. All right, how do we solve these type of problems? Well, you have to translate all constraints and the objective into linear functions of these variables XPE. And then you use integer programming, which uses the branch and bound method. This is one of the typical ways in which these type of problems are solved. And what this is, what this essentially is doing is for each edge, you are deciding, you take this edge or you don't take this edge. So let's look at one edge. So we have Brussels to Atlanta, plane one, day one, hour one. Do we want to take this edge? Yes, no. If you want to take this edge, then we have to decide from Brussels to Atlanta, plane one, day one, hour two. Do we want to take this edge or don't we want to take this edge? And also then if we didn't take the Brussels Atlanta, plane one, day one, hour one edge, then we want to decide Brussels to Atlanta, plane one, day one, hour two. Do we want to take that edge or not? But you can imagine that this binary tree will be huge. It's not possible to go through this whole tree. It's too large, and therefore we need tricks, lots and lots of tricks in order to solve these type of problems. But if you are able to solve these problems, well, everyone wins, because you have a better, well, an optimal solution, which leads to smaller operation costs. There is no more personnel required to create these schedules by hand, because these type of problems are typical problems which people think, well, we don't need an optimization problem. We have people who are solving these problems, right? And so these people which are solving these problems is just personnel, in this case of an airline industry, which are solving these problems by hand. But of course, they are not reaching the optimal solution, not at all. They are just getting a solution which they think is pretty good, right? And they wouldn't know how to check for optimality or whatever. So, and those personnel would no longer be required to create the schedules, because they would be made by a computer. And also you get better work schedules, and so happy crew members on your airplanes. And in this particular example of the airline industry, you would also get less CO2 emissions, as the planes need to fly less kilometers, or maybe kilometers in better, at better winds speeds, etc. Of course, solving this type of problem doesn't happen in a day, so you kind of require a roadmap. First, you have to identify the optimization opportunities. Then you have to compute the value. So you have to look at what are they doing now, and what would we do if we had an optimal solution, and how much is the difference. And then you have to create a proof of concept, and this proof of concept needs to be made into a solution. And then you have to put the solution into practice, and you have to keep improving on that solution, because of course it's real life, not theory, so you can never make a perfect solution. All right, so now in the rest of the talk, I will be discussing a couple of typical methods with which you can solve these type of problems. So the first method which people typically talk about is constraint programming. And I will always use an example to showcase this these methods, an example for which this type of optimization works well. And so for constraint programming, a type of problem which can be solved very well by constraint programming is the car sequencing problem. So in the car sequencing problem, we have these cars which we need to produce in a certain sequence. And first we have this first column, which is saying this 1 out of 5, 2 out of 5, 1 out of 3, 2 out of 3, 1 out of 2. And so each row in this column signifies one particular option, and how many cars can require this option in a sequence of a number of cars. So the first option, 1 out of 5, this means that out of each sequence of 5 cars, only one car can require this option. For a second one, 2 out of 5, this means that out of each sequence of 5 consecutive cars, only 2 cars can require this option. 1 out of 3, you can probably guess, it's out of each 3 sequential cars which are produced, only one can require this option. And so these options are things like a moonroof, or larger tires, or special rear view mirrors, or whatever. So stuff which not every car, leather seats, or stuff like that. All right, then what are these other columns? So I highlight, well, I put an arrow above one of these columns. So in this column, we first have a red rectangle. And so what this red rectangle is telling us is that this car requires this option, but there's a conflict. And indeed, there is a conflict, because this car requires this option, And if you look closely, then you can see that after three cars which do not require this option, then the next car will also require this option. So there we have a sequence of five cars, out of which two require this option. So that's not good, right? Because the machine can't handle this, because only one out of each five cars can require this option. And so therefore we make this rectangle red and we say, okay, here we have an issue. Then the second and the third option are gray rectangles. This means that, okay, this car does not require this option. And then the fourth rectangle is yellow. And so this is telling us, okay, this car requires this option, but it's okay. We can do this. And so indeed, it's a 2 out of 3. And you can see that each sequence of three cars, which contains our car, does not require more than two cars who need this option. All right. We can model this as a constraint programming problem. And what a constraint programming framework will do is it will consider all possibilities in a smart way. So in this case, it will try to put the cars in each possible sequence, but it will try sequences in a smart way. So it will not just enumerate them all and then go through them, but you will have a lot of constraints such that it will then go through the different options in a good way. And to help it converge more quickly, you have to do some addition. You have to add constraints which are not really there in the problem formulation. So, for example, you have symmetry breaking. And what symmetry breaking is doing is saying that, okay, if you have two cars which are actually identical, so in this case, it's if you have two cars which require the same options, then these cars should be seen as the same thing, right? So that you can do using additional constraints, putting additional constraints in the system. And these type of constraints are called symmetry breaking constraints. You can add some redundant constraints, and redundant constraints are things which we obviously know are true, but which the system might not know that are obviously true. So these are this is a general term for these type of constraints, which are just extra additional constraints. Then the value variable labeling. So this is a trick where you can look at the problem from multiple perspectives. So this car sequencing problem, we can look at it from two perspectives. We can either say, okay, we have this car. When should we schedule it? When should we make it? Should we make it as a seventh car or as the 15th car or as the 20th car or whatever? Or we could say, okay, we have this slot. We have slot number 7. Which car should you produce at slot number 7? Should you produce car number 1, 8, 9, or whatever? And so both these labelings can be used. And for both these labelings, you get a different type of constraints to model the problem. And often it will be best to use both labelings, link them using additional constraints, and then just let the system figure out which it will be using, or it might use both. It might use both the value labels and the variable labels to get to an optimal solution as quickly as possible. So the main idea is add as many constraints as you can to the system, such that you can narrow down the search space as much as possible, so that you can scrap as many bad solutions or redundant solutions or symmetrical solutions as possible. You can easily start solving these problems yourself, because there are a lot of frameworks for it. For example, there's Minizinc, which I have put a link to, and OR Tools is made by Google, which is also a framework with which you can do these type of problems. They also have a lot of examples on these type of problems. And on Coursera, there is a pretty interesting course, Basic Modeling for Discrete Optimization, which will specifically look at Minizinc as its example. And they use these funny cartoons as motivational examples for these type of problems. So some advantages of using constraint programming. Good frameworks exist, such as Minizinc or OR Tools, but there are also others, like, for example, OptaPlanner, which was just mentioned to me. You always get guaranteed optimality. So when the solver finishes, you are sure that the solution it gives you is the optimal solution. To implement it, it's very easy, and it's as long as your optimization problems are fairly small, it will give you the optimal solution very quickly. So for this number of cars, it will probably give you the optimal solution fairly quickly. It works well for heavily constrained problems. So if you have a lot of constraints and there are really not that many legal solutions, then this really shines constraint programming. That's also why car sequencing is a good example for this, because for a car sequencing problem, well, there aren't that many configurations which work. Most configurations will not work. So that's also something where constraint programming is very good. And it's great to find feasible solutions. So if you're not really looking for an optimal solution, you don't really have a sense of optimality, but you just want something feasible, then this is also something which constraint programming is very good at. So again, the car sequencing, if you have a sequence such that you can produce all the cars, you're just happy, right? You don't need to do any further work. And if you find another solution, that's just as good. It's not better or worse than the other solution. Some disadvantages. There are, of course, for every method, there are advantages, but also disadvantages. And so if your problem becomes very large, you will run into runtime problems. It will become too slow to solve really, really big problems. It's also not great at finding the optimal solution. So if you have a big search space and you have a lot of feasible solutions and you really have to find the best feasible solution, it's not that great for those type of problems. And you only get small gains from warm starting. So if you have an awesome greedy solution which gets you very close to the optimal solution already, then constraint programming will not be able to use that greedy solution that well. It will be able to use it, but it won't give it that much of a head start. All right, then a second method which people often use and talk about is mixed integer programming. And so an example of something which can be optimized very well with mixed integer programming is the warehouse location problem. So here you have a number of warehouses. These are the blue houses. Those are the warehouses. And then you have a set of customers, and you have to decide for each warehouse, will I open this warehouse or won't I open this warehouse? Opening a warehouse entails a cost, so each warehouse costs you money to open it. But of course, what you want to minimize is the total distance that all these customers have to travel to your warehouses. So in this case, you might, for example, want to open this warehouse and then this one on the right, and then all customers which are the closest to this one will go there, and all the ones which are closest to this one will go there. But of course, this is a very small example. And so for larger examples, this becomes a difficult optimization problem, because for each of these warehouses, you'll have to decide 0 or 1. Do you want to open it or don't want you open it? And so the complexity of it is 2 to the power n, where n is the number of warehouses which you have. The main idea of mixed integer programming is that you use linear programming to upper bound the objective, and then you use heuristics to lower bound the solution. And so you have this upper bound found by the linear programming, you have these heuristics to give you a lower bound, and then at the point when this lower bound and this upper bound coincide, then you know that you have found the optimal solution, and then you can stop your algorithm. So the tricks in the toolbox of mixed integer programming contain linear programming, which is probably well known to you. Then stuff like cutting planes. This is like a method to cut away solutions which are not integer, because you know that all your variables are integer, or at least some variables are integer. And for variables which are integer, you can cut away the parts of your feasible region which are not integer. Those parts you can cut away because you know that the solution has to be integer. So that's the idea behind these cutting planes. And then branch and cut. This is like the branching method which I showed for the airplanes, where you decide for each of the nodes whether or not you want to take that one. So, and there are many, many more methods of solving this. And to start solving this yourself, again, there are many things you can use. Also, Gurobi is maybe an honorable mention. But I will mention here the Python MIP package, which is very well documented and also contains a lot of examples. And there you can really start solving this very quickly, very easily yourself. And so that brings me to the first main advantage of mixed integer programming. Again, good frameworks exist. Like, for example, this pythonmip.com. There you have a very good framework which allows you to model these problems and solve them to optimality with almost no knowledge of how this works, actually. You are guaranteed to reach optimality. So when the solver stops, you will know the solution you got is the optimal solution. Again, it's easy and fast to implement, and it works very well for small problems. And it works very well also for large problems when you have a good formulation. So this good is underlined because this is very, very important. But this is also very hard to grasp and to really understand what this means to have a good solution. But in a few words, what I want to say about it is that the best integer solution should be very close to the best solution. So in the airline problem, which I mentioned, the best integer solution is a solution where these XPE variables are either 0 or 1. And the best solution is this is the same problem where we have these variables XPE, which do not need to be 0 or 1, but they just have to be in the interval 0, 1. Right? So they can also be 0.5, 0.4, 0.99, or whatever. And so when these two solutions are very close to each other, then you will see that this mixed integer programming framework works very, very well. But yeah, this is an important point and a very difficult point to get right. So this brings us to the disadvantages. Well, it only works for linear models. You really need the objective and the constraints to be linear functions. You get into runtime problems for large problems, except, of course, if you're this very good solution. But this gives us the main disadvantage. It's very hard to find good formulations. This is really very, very hard. All right, then the third and last, I believe, method which I will talk about are meta heuristics or normal heuristics. And an example here is the vehicle routing problem. So as I said in the first slide, you have this factory. This factory has to supply goods to customers. You have these trucks, and you have to send these trucks around to these customers. The main idea of meta heuristics in general is that you want to combine a local search algorithm and a smart search method to find a good solution. So you have a local search algorithm, which is very good at finding a good local solution. And then you have to put this local search algorithm into a bigger picture, where this bigger picture is something which will go to this local solution and then that local optima, then that local optima, and it will really find its way to a very good global solution. And so inspiration can be found at this handbook of meta heuristics by Michel Gondreau, but also there are many other references, but this is one which I looked at, so that's why I mentioned it here. And I think it's a good book, but you can do with the advice what you want, of course. So advantages of using these meta heuristics is that it's highly scalable. So when your problems become very large, you will often want to go to these meta heuristics because they scale like crazy. They don't really care that much about the size of your problem. It's very fast because you use these local greedy methods, and they are very fast to find these local solutions. And then this global search method thing is just directing it, so that all that's also not that much work. General methodologies exist, but yeah, I say here methodologies, not frameworks. So methodologies are things, yeah, which you need to read and know about before you can start implementing it. And it works for almost all problems. So the previous problems, you could also make meta heuristics for them if you wanted to. Then some disadvantages, there's more implementation overhead because of the lack of these good frameworks. Of course, there are frameworks, but they are not nearly as well developed as for the mixed integer programming or for the constraint programming. There's no guarantee of optimality. It's a heuristic, like the name says it. So it's not going to tell you, yeah, this is certainly the best solution which you can ever find. So there's no optimality guarantee. And sometimes it's hard to pick an appropriate method. So there are many, many meta heuristics, and you might find it difficult to find which meta heuristic you should use for your problem at hand. Let me go into more detail on these meta heuristics, in particular for a maximization problem, just to give you an idea of how this search method works in general. So you first generate a greedy solution, S. At that point, we set it equal to S optimal because we don't know any better, right? It's the only solution we have. So for us, it's the optimal solution at this point. Then using this S, we let S minus denote S with some part removed. So we have this S, we remove some part of the S, and that's our S minus. And then we repair this removed part again. Then we denote this by S plus. So we have S, we remove a part, that's S minus. Then we repair that part again, that's S plus. And then we have this possibility P of S plus minus S minus. This is the likelihood of accepting the solution S plus. Of course, if S plus is better than S, then we'll probably accept it. But if it's worse, we shouldn't always reject it, right? So this P will be a function of this S plus minus S minus. And this P will probably be increasing, right? The better S plus, the more probability that we will be accepting it. But it's a P which you, and the definition of this P is very problem dependent also. Then the probability 1 minus P of S plus minus S. So this is the probability that we do not accept the solution S plus. Then we just return to the previous step and we again denote this S minus defined on the S which we already had. If we do accept this S plus, then we will set S equal to S plus. So then this is our new solution. And if this S plus is better than our current optimal solution, well, then this is our new optimal solution, right? So this S plus is always the new solution which we found. And if it's better than the optimal solution which we had, then we will define it as the new optimal solution. And if we have accepted this solution S, then we will go back to defining this S minus. And this loop goes on and on and on and on until we have an S opt, which we think is good enough. All right, and for the repair method, so the defining of this S plus, that's what we call the repair method. There you can typically use a greedy method. If you know any good greedy methods for your solution, for your problem setting, then great. You can use those to repair your solution. But you can also use the frameworks, which I mentioned earlier, constraint programming and mixed integer programming, because what were the main disadvantages of constraint programming and mixed integer programming? Well, the main disadvantages were that it doesn't work well for big problems, right? But here we are only removing a small part of the solution. So by definition of this method, what we are creating is a small problem. And so for small problems, this constraint programming and mixed integer programming works well. So therefore, this repair method can very well be just a constraint programming or a mixed integer programming solution. All right, so I hope you have an idea of the type of methodologies which can be used to solve these type of problems. I hope you know, you now have an idea of which kind of problems we're talking about. And of course, this is, I think, primarily people here are primarily interested in like big data and machine learning and stuff like that, and not that interested in these small data problems, these optimization problems with only little data. But of course, the big data machine learning world can go hand in hand with these discrete optimization problems. And to this end, I will recap on this example again, the vehicle routing problem. Because the big data machine learning folk, they will use a lot of data to predict the demand of these customers. They will predict the traffic on the roads to these customers and much more things which they will predict. Based on all these predictions, they will create a graph network with on this graph network, the demand and the congestion on the roads and whatever. Then this Then this graph network will be fed to the optimizer of the discrete optimization person. He will optimize his routes, and then he will deliver an optimal schedule to the customer. So it's actually a cooperation between the big data person and the small data person to get an optimal schedule to the person who is working at the factory. Some further resources which I would like to mention, I will go very quickly over these. So on Coursera, you have these pretty nice courses. I really liked the discrete optimization course from Pascal van Hentenrijk. I also took some of the examples from that course. And I also like the basic modeling for discrete optimization, which I mentioned earlier for the Minisync. Then here are some books on the on these type of methods. I also want to mention operations research, which is like an over, which is like a broad area, which also contains discrete optimization and some tools which you can use, these OR tools, this Python MIP. I should maybe also mention Minisync here. And so this Python MIP also contains very nice examples at this URL. And with that said, I would like to thank you for watching this presentation. And I hope that I have inspired you to start using discrete optimization in your day-to-day life and also your career. So thank you.
Okay, and we thank you, Tim, for this very interesting talk. And can I remind the people who are watching and listening to us that they can put the questions in the chat area. And I see that there's already one question, but I have a question of my own as well. When I was studying, and it's a long time ago, almost 30 years now, I remembered classes, or the operations research classes from the legendary Professor Van Winkle. But a lot of the things that you have mentioned were already known then. So can you give us a quick overview of, let's say, the biggest improvements of the last couple of years compared to back in the time?
Although, yeah, indeed, these methods which I talk about are methods which are indeed well established in general. Well, I guess as for with the big data, machine learning stuff, the main advantage is that computers have become faster, and so therefore you can solve bigger optimization problems, and also with this data you can generate these problems better. So like in so the hand-in-hand stuff, I mean, it goes better now, right? So you can just use it on more problems. But really, I know the mixed integer programming has improved significantly. So in mixed integer programming, theoretical results, it started, I think, in World War II. In World War II, people started solving these type of problems. But like the theory, the type of cuts that are defined and such, they are really much better now than they were then. So for example, Gurobi is a package which is has been existing for a long time. I think they now are at version, I don't know, 7 or 11 or something like that. So if you would use their solver, their first version of a solver, and you would solve the same problem with their first version or their current version, I think you would get a speed up like times 1,000 or something. So
okay,
there are a lot of improvements in the theory, certainly a lot of improvements in the theory there. Yeah.
Good. That's very good to know. Thank you. We have a question from Koen Ruimbeek. Okay. And he asks, is it possible that you can allow that certain conditions are broken for a fixed number of times if the gain is large enough?
Yeah, sure. So I think this question relates to the fact that if you have this search method, then you have these constraints and you would typically want to look for feasible solutions. So you would look in the space of feasible solutions and you would go from feasible solution to feasible solution. But you could also go outside the set of feasible solutions. So you could say like, okay, this solution might not be feasible, but it's a good solution to look at, and maybe we can go to a better solution. We can travel to a better solution through this path, right? So if you picture it like you have the optimal solution, which is right over this wall, but this wall is like where the solutions are not feasible anymore, then you can certainly go through that wall by allowing to not obey all constraints. So you don't always have to obey all constraints when you are solving these problems. Yeah. But at the end, you should always get to a feasible solution, because otherwise,
it's no solution. That's great. Thank you again, Tim. And I think, Chris, you really need to do some multitasking, because now you have to put yourself on the screen. This is going to get very complicated. So the next speaker is Chris Peters. And, you know, one of the things that I've learned is that data minded has a space between the data and the minded. I didn't know that. And I guess there's also a space between Chris and Peters, and he will talk about the data engineering manifesto. And I am really looking forward to that. Chris, it's all yours.
Thank you. Well, indeed, I'll be doing some multitasking. So Tim and Isvan, I'll remove you from the screen again and then hijack the rest of the meetup.
Yep.
But I'll give it back to you, Isvan, when I'm done. Tim, once again, thank you. Thank you for your talk. It was super interesting. Thank you very much. So I've been asked to do a talk at the very last moment because the professor was not available. So you have to do with the next best thing, which is me. It happened to be that I just did a webinar yesterday around the Data Engineering Manifesto. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Chris. Well, you probably know me from Data Science Leuven, but next to that, I also work at a company called Data Minded, indeed, and we're more focused on data engineering than data science. And so we've written down a manifesto, if you will, just to explain the principles and the things that we try to apply when we work on data engineering projects. Before we go into that manifesto, I actually like to ask you a question. So I put a link here in the YouTube chat, and let me share my screen as well. So the idea is that you go to that link, and you fill out the first question that pops up there. So the first question is, if you go to that link, post it in the chat, or you go to menti.com and you type in the code 32407003. Then I'm going to ask you a few questions around data engineering. So I'm trying to gauge here how well you understand data engineering. When we did this webinar, of course, it was for companies who knew data minded and who knew data engineering. So we got some skewed results, as Isvan would say, because these people know what data engineering is about mostly. So I'm curious if you fill this out, what the results will be like. And the questions are, do you, and in your organization, do you understand what data engineering is? Do you apply data engineering best practices in your organization? It could be your work, or it could be your study group, or it could be your research institute, or it could be whatever. Do you see data engineering as a part of your success? And do you want to invest more in data engineering? The first few answers coming in, and there is some delay on the between the YouTube channel and the live stream, so I'll wait for a bit to have a few more answers popping in. I really appreciate if you fill this out, so it gives me a better context of the audience. Seven already here, so that's really great, and we already see some interesting trends. So most of you don't really know what. Well, at least in your organization, don't really know what data engineering is. Although plenty of you do apply data engineering best practices, but I guess it's not super well understood across the organization, which we also see coming back at our clients, right? It's there's a lot of confusion around what data engineering really is supposed to be. A lot of you think it's important, so that's good. I like that. Especially when I'm talking to an audience of data scientists, I think it's important that data engineering is seen as a key part of success, because sometimes they consider it as plumbing, I guess. And you want to invest more in data engineering skills as well, so that's good. Well, this gives me an overview. I'm going to ask you one more question before I begin. Can you describe data engineering in your own words? So just type down when you think about data engineering, or what do you think about, or what do you think the job of a data engineer is? So just go to Mentimeter and type in what you think. Press enter. I'll wait for a bit again, because again, there is some delay on the YouTube channel, so it takes a while before the answers pop up. But the idea would be, of course, that hopefully the answers you give here kind of relate to the manifesto that we've built, right? So it shouldn't be a complete gap between the manifesto and the answers here. The data science stuff without formulas, that's new to me. I've never heard this definition. I like it. Prepare the data such that it's well organized and easy to do analysis on. Yes, definitely. Connect and clean the data from source to the consumer. Yeah, yeah, it's all recognizable. Let's wait a bit for a few more answers. Create efficient algorithms to understand the available data for non-data scientists. Yeah. So it's a lot about making data available, prepping data, doing everything around data science that's not really mathematics related, I guess. I'll wait for a bit more to see some more answers coming in. Data science and production, that is a super important aspect of it indeed. We're going to talk about that as well. So normally I did a webinar with somebody else, a data miner, that would have an interactive discussion. That's not possible today, so I'll just do the talking, I guess. But this gives me a good overview, so thanks for that. We're going to go to the presentation itself now. So let's go there. That was the Mentimeter. So there was 10 guiding principles for data engineering. That's how we called it, but I learned that actually it wasn't 10, it was 9, so I misunderstood. So we have 9 guiding principles. It's an off by one error. It's one of the classic mistakes in data science or in IT in general, if you will. So it's 9 guiding principles that we use every day, and I hope this is also helpful to you. So number one, the first principle is we are software engineers. What do we mean by that? Like a data engineer, well, what it says there, right? We create software by writing code while following best practices. This includes adopting software design principles, version control, automated testing, CI/CD, all of these things. Why do we think this is important? Is because it's very often misunderstood or underappreciated, if you will, like the value of some proper software engineering that if you do some data science for research purposes or just to gain some insights and then take those insights to do something else, you can basically do whatever you want. But if you want to build more production-grade systems, which include some data science aspects maybe, but that you really want to reuse, that you want to deploy to production, have day-to-day impact on, really those software engineering principles help you in day-to-day lives. So that's an important first principle, if you will, that really, as a data engineer, you should really think like, hey, I actually try to apply software engineering best practices to data. And related to that, I always say that if you actually want to predict the future of data engineering, you just have to look at what's hot in software engineering 5 or 10 years ago. Because what they were doing in software engineering 5 or 10 years ago now starts to become popular in data engineering. We kind of lag behind the curve there. So an example of that is domain-driven design, which has been practiced in software engineering since 2006. It's now, since a year or so, the topic of a data mesh is very hot in data engineering. I don't know if you've heard about data mesh architectures, but it's just applying domain-driven design in software engineering, in data engineering. So it's one of these examples that we've known that for a long time in software engineering, and now we're discovering it in the data world as well. Second principle, and kind of relates to that, is data is a product. What do we mean by that? Is that for a very long time, data was actually considered to be an exhaust of processes. So you had a whole bunch of operational processes, like you had customer relationship management that you have to do, you had to do stock management, you had to do a website, yeah, like sales transactions, all of these things. They were considered to be, these are my operational systems. And yeah, as a byproduct of these operational systems, as an exhaust, if you will, data is being generated, which is captured by the analytics team to build BI reports or to build machine learning algorithms, next product to buy, recommendation, whatever you have. But the thing is that actually treating it as an exhaust is too simplistic. It's a bit outdated. And more, you should companies start to see like, hey, my data is actually a product and I should treat it as a product. So when you build operational systems, you should think about how do I offer this data to the rest of the organization? Which quality metrics do I apply to that? How do I publish this? How will other people use this? And if you do it that way, it will make it a lot more easy to reuse data across the organization. So I think we're relatively new to the market here. Not a lot of companies are mature enough to be here to treat data as a product. But I think the most advanced ones are, and it's definitely a recommendation to the rest of you to also try to treat data when you have data in your organization, treat it as, as a product and not as an exhaust. It really helps in building reliable data pipelines. Because often what we see is like a data pipeline breaks and it's because something at the source has changed and it breaks your schema. Well, that's nothing that you can't solve that with technology. There's no technology out there that I know you have automatic schema change detection and whatnot, but it's really a organizational or principle problem. Like try to figure out, try to respect contracts between parties. The next one is a bit of a mouthful, but we enable by providing self-service solutions. Why do we think this is important? What is this in the first place? Is that in the survey, a lot of things came back, like data engineer has to provide clean data to the rest of the organization, which is true. But at the same time, data engineers are very much in demand. There's really a bottleneck on hiring data engineers in every organization, right? Everybody's struggling with the same problem. They never have enough technical people to build their data platforms and their data systems. So in order to break that bottleneck a bit, we really encourage you to, as much as possible, build systems that are as self-service as possible. So that you as a data engineer, you enable other people to do their work. So a very concrete example is sometimes a good way to serve data to the rest of the organization is by building what they call a materialized view in SQL. Well, a materialized view is actually, building your first or second materialized view is a lot of fun. Building your 99th or 100th materialized view is really boring. So you should look in ways like, how can I set up data access and my database in such a way so that everybody can build their own materialized views, which still follow right data governance principles and whatnot. And I don't have to do that myself, but I just teach everybody else to run materialized views. And I'm going to sound like a fanboy here, but one technology that really helps with this is a relatively new technology called DBT. DBT is data build tool, and it allows you to build data pipelines using plain SQL. So you don't need to know Python or Spark or R. If you know SQL, and a lot of data analysts and scientists know SQL, if you know SQL, you can build your own data pipelines. And that's an example of building a self-service solution that helps, that enables the rest of the organization. And it will remove a lot of the pressure from you as a data engineer. It will remove you as a bottleneck. So it's really, this is one of the key, key success factors that we look for when we do projects, like how can we make this more self-service? Which bottlenecks can we take away here? Fourth principle, it's very opinionated. Not everybody might agree with me here. If you don't agree, post it in the chat. I'm curious to find out. We embrace cloud and managed services. Why is that? We think you can just be a lot more productive by using cloud and by using managed services. So some data engineers have the tendency to say, hey, I want to set up everything myself from bare metal servers, doing the networking, installing the OS, upgrading the OS, installing the database, patching the database, making file backups, whatnot. These are all steps that you have to do that don't add a lot of business value. It's a lot of fun to do them engineering-wise, but they don't add a lot of business value. So ideally, you take as much off the shelf as possible so you can focus on the things that really matter to the business. And these days, it's really a combination of cloud and managed services that can do that. So let's go to the next principle, if you will, is batch processing is easier than stream processing. It's again one of these things that is very opinionated. But what we see a lot of data engineers do is streaming is hot. Streaming is sexy. You can do Kafka streams or Spark streaming or Flink or Lambda functions or what have you. And it's really cool to build a streaming pipeline and to think about all these complex streaming processes in reality. And this is sometimes a bitter pill to swallow, but in reality, there's two counter arguments to this. Is one, often the business doesn't need it. Sometimes they do, right? But often they don't. And two is like, it's harder than you think to build that stream process. So yes, you can write the application to do stream processing, but no, you don't want to maintain that. Really, a batch process that triggers once a day or once an hour, if you will, it's a lot easier to handle than doing a stream process. And this is not just theoretical. We've seen quite a few large companies with big budgets, right? Like, these are companies registered in the Bell 20, like the one top 20 companies, and they struggle with stream processing. So I would really think twice, three times, four times before you start building a streaming pipeline. And there are good use cases, right? Sometimes you want to do real-time predictions of what's going on, and then a streaming use case is streaming implementation is the way to go. But very often, I think 9 out of 10 streaming implementations we've seen actually don't add a lot of value. Could as well just been a batch process. Six, and it comes back to, it kind of relates to five, is that we aim for simplicity through consistency. So if you try to be consistent across projects, across implementations, you get a lot more simpler architecture in the end. So what we see in practice, a lot of organizations, they have different teams, different data teams, they all have their old tool preferences also in this community, right? Some of you really like Python, some of you really like R, some of you might like Julia, or like the million other tools that are out there that you like. And very often you start a project hoping that you can use your own tools, which make a lot of sense because you are most productive in those tools, right? But if you look at it from a company perspective, I think the average time that an engineer or a scientist stays at a particular company is like 2 or 3 years or something. So if you have a team of 10, and every 2 or 3 years that entire team is cycled, and there's 10 other people, there's three new people, three new engineers or scientists joining every year or something. This causes a lot of flux of people with a lot of flux of technologies. And if you don't manage that whatsoever, you get a landscape that nobody can maintain anymore. After 2 or 3 years, you need to understand 20 technologies to print out hello world in your data science use case. And that really doesn't fly. So again, try to avoid the complex technologies, choose the simple technologies that work. I often say, like, I can solve 90% of use cases with a Postgres database and a Python script. The same probably applies to your project. If you can do it with Python and Postgres, then why would you involve something more complex than that? This is a very opinionated one, especially in the data science community. So I'm really hoping to see what you think about this one. But as an engineer, we really think that notebooks are for research, they're not for development. And I know a lot of you probably do a lot of notebook development. And that's fine. For exploration and a bit of experimentation and hacking around and discovering what the data looks like and discovering what you actually try to build, the interactivity of a notebook is amazing. Like, nothing beats a notebook in that phase. What often goes wrong, though, is that people write a notebook, and in the end, they get a result. They just schedule the notebook and be done with it. That is a recipe for disaster. It is very hard to maintain such notebooks because they're built in a very ad hoc fashion. They're not structured. They're not modularized. It's very hard to reuse the code. It's very hard to test the code. It's very hard to add features to it or to change a feature because nobody really understands what happened in the notebook. So our recommendation there is a proper IDE, so an integrated development environment, is the right tool for the job. And I know this is sometimes a difficult step to take, and this, again, something that you should guide and help data scientists as much as you can. But in the end, there is nothing, comes back to, we are software engineers, there's nothing better than having modular code structured in libraries that are automatically tested, that are automatically deployed, that are versioned. I can't tell you how many times I've seen teams go into production very quickly, be very happy, high-five each other with their notebook, and then still be stuck with that a year later and don't move any further because they're stuck in the mud all the time. There are large companies like Netflix who put their notebooks in production, but they have built entire systems automation around that, that if you do it like Netflix, and if you have the budget of Netflix, and if you have the engineering talent of Netflix, then yes, you can put notebooks in production. But it's not just a matter of scheduling your notebook and saying, now I'm live. It's a lot of orchestration that goes around that. This one is also very, very helpful in this meetup, I guess. Data scientists are our colleagues, not our mortal enemies. So for those of you who work in industry, what we sometimes see is there is a schism, like a very strong divide between data engineers and data scientists. Very much like in IT, there has always been a very strong divide between developers and operations. Like, yeah, the developers doing the cool stuff, and then they throw it over the fence to run it. Like, dear stupid operations people, you're responsible for running it. That's the easy part. I as a developer, I'm smart. I'm a genius. I developed the code. Well, that's complete nonsense, right? And the same sometimes we see in the data science world, where data scientists go like, I'm the brilliant scientist. I built a very cool algorithm. So now I'm going to throw this over the fence to the stupid data engineer just to do the implementation work, because how hard can it be to just implement the hard part has been solved, right? I built the algorithm already. That's like a dysfunctional marriage that never works. It's always, you have the same goal. It's only when a good algorithm that has been designed by a smart data scientist that has been put in production in a proper scalable way by a data engineer, only then an algorithm delivers value to the business, right? Not when it runs on your laptop, not when your notebook has a high lift curve or whatever you want to call it. It's only valuable when it runs in production. So it's about collaborating between data scientists and data engineers. Ideally, they're all in the same team. So no handovers, just there's a team to deliver a business case, and there might be some data science involved, there might be some data engineering involved, but you're all in the same team, right? And then finally, we already go to the last principle. So again, leave your questions in the comments, or if you disagree with something, let me know. And then we go back to Mentimeter as well. I have a few questions for you. The final one is SQL or SQL is the lowest common denominator. There's been a lot of debate about technologies. There's also been a time where SQL was not cool anymore, and everybody went for the NoSQL databases because, well, SQL is a drag. I think we can all agree that SQL is an amazing language. And I also think that almost everybody, if not everybody in the data space, should be able to learn SQL. Like, what you do next to SQL is really up to you, but SQL is such an expressive, powerful data analytics language that you should know SQL and something more on top of that. We don't believe it's all about a matter levels of abstraction. I know SQL abstracts more away from you than Python or Spark or R. And for some, that might be too much, and they like the control that they have of Python. I understand that. But sometimes they also go in the other direction. So, no, we need to abstract more away. I'm going to do drag and drop tools where I don't know how to write a join, but I can drag a join box to a screen, and then I can drag a CSV file to the join box and another CSV file, and I've created a join. Thinking that if you don't have to write SQL, that's going to be easier. Well, the reality that we've seen, and we're very opinionated about this, we've never seen drag and drop tools work at scale in production grade environments. So they work, again, for experimentation purposes like a notebook, fine. But for production environments, we've seen plenty of companies start with drag and drop tools, but then very often it's just empty boxes or like meaningless boxes. And if you look into the box, it's just a SQL statement in that box, right? So really, SQL should be the base layer that you connect everybody to. And then build on top, if you will, but learn SQL as a basis, if you will. So those were, in summary, the nine principles. Again, when we did the webinar, there was a lot of interactive discussion around it, so that was a lot more fun than me just giving them to you like straight. But it's interesting to see how you look at them. So I'm going to go back to the Mentimeter. And then I'm going to give you an opportunity to ask some questions, and then later I have another thing. But so ask your questions in the Mentimeter if you have questions. I'm also going to look at the questions on YouTube already to see if I can answer those. All right. Is vendor lock-in still a thing? Yes and no. That's always been a thing, and that will always remain a thing. So What is vendor lock-in? For those of you who don't know, vendor lock-in is that you build your entire pipelines or your entire systems on one technology from one vendor. And then at some moment you realize you want to move away from that vendor, but just selecting a new database is cheap, but moving all your workloads away from that vendor is very expensive. So in that sense, that's still a thing, but it becomes less of an issue, if you will. So what we saw 10 or 20 years ago is that everybody would base their entire technology stack on one vendor, like the Oracles or IBMs of this world. You just bought everything from Oracle and then everything would work nicely together. That is a very risky business. We kind of see something similar in, we're big cloud fanboys, but if you do everything from one cloud vendor, like you do everything in Azure or everything in AWS, you kind of create some kind of lock-in. You always have some kind of lock-in. Don't avoid lock-in altogether, but try to minimize it. So how can you minimize lock-in? By standardizing on common technology. So SQL, Python, Spark, they're all common across cloud vendors, across spaces. You can run those things anywhere. Another level of abstraction is that you wrap everything in a Docker container. Docker containers run everywhere these days. If you use Kubernetes, Kubernetes runs everywhere these days. So that's a good way to avoid vendor lock-in. Let's see. Completely agree with point 7 about notebooks. Well, good to know, Istvan. Thank you. What do you think about low-code, no-code, visual process design approaches that can be designed faster and maintained easier than Python and SQL? Well, Ralph, I think we can debate on that, but I don't agree with your statement. I think the low-code and no-code visual drag-and-drop processes, yes, you can get to a result faster, I think, an initial result, but then maintaining that is a lot harder. At least that's what we see in practice. I know not everybody agrees with me here. I mean, there's an entire industry of low-code, no-code tools. I think in general, they are useful in very particular use cases. So let me think very simple things. Like, I like a lot Airtable. I don't know if you know about Airtable, but it's kind of a more scripted way to do Excel, if you will. And for very basic use cases, that's more than good enough. And so maybe the same with drag and drop tools. If you have a very simple data transformation pipeline that's very easy to maintain and you just need to do a simple grouping and filtering and I don't agree with that, but if you think it's easier to do a drag and drop than to build, to write that and express that in SQL, then do it. But if it's part of a production grade pipeline and you need to automate deployments and you need to version control changes and you need to, if something changes, you need to, or if schema changes, you need to fix that across all your code base. I've never seen that being successful. But Ralph, I mean, get in touch. I'm happy to have a more fundamental discussion about that in person. And you're already replying. SQL as a base layer, how do you process text, images, audio, and SQL? SQL alone is not enough. You also need non-SQL data storage and other types of processing logics. I agree with you that SQL is not enough. Like, it's very poor at PDF documents and web pages and stuff like that. But I think 80 or 90% of the use cases you can do with SQL, as I said, like Postgres and Python combined, I can do all these use cases. Obviously, I hit scaling issues somewhere, and then I need to have another database in Postgres. Maybe I need another processing system than Python, or I need to scale it out somehow. But for many use cases, that is still, again, 80 or 90% of use cases that we've seen in reality can be solved by Python and Postgres. But again, let's have a chat offline. Maybe I'm curious to see which use cases that you typically work on that don't work that way. I think the main answers questions were in the chat, so nothing here on Mentimeter. I would like to ask you to go to the next slide on Mentimeter, though, is that we discussed the principles here. So if you go again to menti.com and type in 3240 and the code, or you follow the chat again, you see the 9 principles listed again, and I would like you to rate those principles to, are you applying this, just to understand, like, are you already doing this? And do you think we should be applying this on the y-axis? So it's 2 different axes to rate this on. And then ideally we should see things that are obvious to everybody here on the right. Like, yeah, we all agree with you, Chris. We are applying this and we should be applying this. Those should be here. And like things you don't agree with, like we should be applying, we shouldn't be applying this, and we're also not applying this should be here, right? So ideally, this is for me a feedback loop to understand like which things do you agree with and which things don't you agree with, or which things do you think are valuable and which things are not so valuable. In the meantime, while you're filling that out, I'm going to wait for a bit and see Ralph. Yeah, Ralph, sorry for this very asynchronous communication here, but he says, Ralph says, hey, low-code tools offer deployment by a mouse click. No need to translate to SQL, Python, version control included. 80% of our use cases include text analytics, not just tabular data. Well, Ralph, again, if it works for you, but now we see if it works for you, it's great, right? So if you are productive in a tool, any tool, like, and you're serving business needs and your clients are happy, then let nobody else tell you that it doesn't work, right? You decide what works for you and you decide to be successful with that. We have many customers that scale no code analytics, blah, blah, blah. I have to discuss offline to ralph@rapidminer.com. So Ralph, it is fair enough, right? But you are a vendor, right? You sell a no code, low code solution. So it's fair enough for you to defend that one. But again, I haven't seen it work at scale. Maybe you have because you work at one of the vendors. but indeed, maybe Alf, we should take this offline. I would honestly be interested in having an open discussion and learn more about that particular one. Yeah. In the meantime, we have a first one coming in. It's just only one answer, but at least we see, let's go over this, that where we fully agree is do self-service, do batch processing and treat data scientists as colleagues. What we don't really agree is SQL as the lowest common denominator. At least from this very small sample set, it's interesting to see that the y-axis is quite high. So you all agree like, yeah, we should be doing this. Yes, Chris, we should be doing this. But are we doing this? Not really. Okay, so it's updating as we speak, right? You see this live popping up, okay. Let's see what like 1 and 6 and 2 maybe, or the we are software engineers, not all of you are convinced. Treat dating as a product, also not all of you are convinced. We aim for simplicity. I guess some of you want more complexity. That I find weird. I think 1 and 2 is a bit controversial, but you should all aim for simplicity. Honestly, believe me, like whatever else I told you. Complex systems are super hard to manage. You don't want to manage a complex system, really. let's see. It's update 10 results already. It's interesting. 8, a lot of people agree with it. Of course, it's a data science meetup, right? So yeah, a lot of you agree with 8. One of you says like, no, we should not be applying this principle. by the way, I'm reading the axes wrong, I think. I'm sorry, I'm not a data scientist. So low on the x, low here on the y-axis means you should not be applying it, and low on the x-axis is you're not doing it yet. But anyway, it doesn't really matter because they all clutter together here. But you should not be applying your some doubt about SQL. I guess Ralphie also pitched in here. Some doubts about simplicity, which this one is the most shocking for me. Simplicity, maybe. That's weird. Maybe you just want to use your own tools, I guess. You all agree with these ones. So yeah, that's cool. Notebooks, there's a lot of, let's say, a mix opinions about notebooks. Some of you really like notebooks and some of you really say, no, we should not be applying this at all. We are applying it, but we should not be applying it at all. So yeah, it's interesting to learn. Okay, I see someone else. Quentin says, hey, I agree about streaming versus batch. Many clients want streaming data because it sounds cool, but there's no real advantage to its situations. But one observation per minute is the extent of the usage. Yeah, exactly. That's also what we see. And I mean, as consultants, we like to do streaming use cases. We really enjoy building streaming analytics pipelines. It's not often to the benefit of the client. Some use cases definitely are, but most of them are not. Yeah, so with that, I think I'd like to wrap up. These were the 9 data engineering principles that we grouped together in a data engineering manifesto. We did a webinar yesterday around that, and there is a next webinar coming. I'll post, let me see if I can post a link here on the chat of the webinar. If you want to join the webinar and have a more interactive discussion, because this is a bit boring, feel free to join the webinar on this next week. We're doing an extra webinar. Why? It's because I butchered the sound in the previous webinar. And it was really bad for recording, and we need another one to publish. So Rob says, so if you aim for simplicity, consistency, you have to set some rules and guidelines. Yes, Rob, that is super important. And this really is a trade-off between freedom and long-term success. We've seen clients that go like, hey, I just won't let my scientists do whatever they want to do, and I want to let my engineers do whatever they want to do. So here's an empty Amazon account or an empty Azure account or an empty Google account, and do whatever you want. If we're really being honest, after 2 years, they did 9 times the same thing in different accounts with 12 different technologies, and it was super hard to maintain. So the long-term success of such an endeavor is very questionable. If you look at how Netflix does it, they also put constraints that they say, hey, these are the languages we support. I think depending on the size of your organizations, I would propose to support a few technologies that you know as an organization we can support them even if after the engineers leave. And pick one of the obvious ones, right? Like a Python, an SQL, Spark, something like that. It depends on which kind of organization you are. But then once you have those, be consistent in applying them. I know you won't make friends in the short term, but you will have long-term success. I'm going to add Istvan back to the stream. So Istvan, make sure you're dressed again. I'm going to put you back on YouTube.
Okay. Well, thank you for that, Chris. So we still have a few minutes for some more questions, but I do have some questions or maybe some remarks rather, because, well, as you know, Chris, I am probably more of a data scientist than a data engineer. But if you look at data science in business, then you immediately talk about consistency, efficiency, robustness, and all these things. And that all implies data engineering. So I don't really see the contradiction or the animosity between the two. I really think that the two are required. And yes, there are a couple of people who are good in both, but the majority of us have specializations. Yeah. And I do somewhat more to the direction of data science, and then they should, let's say, admit their weaknesses in the other area and vice versa. Where I see things going wrong is when a data scientist insists with having their code untouched in production, or vice versa, which is even funnier, a data engineer who is making an algorithm. but that doesn't work. So is that something that you also see in your experience with data minded?
It really depends on the maturity level. So what you say here, of course, and I don't want to suck up to you or whatever, but you are super experienced in the data world. So you understand the trade-offs and you understand the importance of all of this. But in general, I think because there was this, there's been a lot of hype around data science, let's be honest, right? So a lot of companies hire data scientists fresh out of school, like the smartest minds, and say, hey, do fancy data science stuff for me in a data lab, shielded from business, because you don't want to be bothered by business, right? You all only want to do fancy mathematics or fancy algorithms. And they after a year or 2 years of that, they often get disappointed by results, because obviously if you're not connected to business, why are you doing it in the first place, right? And even in data science intensive projects that we do, let's deploy a recommendation algorithm. If you're really being honest, 90% of the work of any data science project is you could consider as data engineering. So maybe it's because data engineering is less mature than data science. I'm willing to admit that we need to have better automation, better tooling, so that not 90% of the work is data engineering, but that's just reality. 90% of your work is data engineering. Even as a data scientist, a lot of it is cleaning the data, finding the right data sources, cataloging your data, all of that. And then the algorithm work actually in itself is relatively small. And so the answer indeed is not like we're going to automate away the data scientist or we're going to automate away the data engineer. Both of that is bullshit. The answer is you need to collaborate and build a use case together. Xavier says, oh my God, you're telling my story.
Good. I like that remark, you're telling my story. And with that, I think we still have 1 minute, but let's use that as the summary of your talk. So with that, I would like to thank Tim Hellemans again, and obviously also Chris Peters, not only for giving an interesting talk, but also for willing to give this talk at such a, well, literally the last minute almost.
Yeah, the last 15 minutes. I got a message
from 15 minutes before the start. So then I would like to remind, and there he is, Tim, he didn't run away. I would like to remind our viewers that on Friday, the 4th of June, that's a week from now, a little bit more than a week from now, we have the 38 Data Science Leuven meetup, and then Chris will be hosting.
And not talking about it.
That's a good reason. That's a good reason to join us then as well. Yeah. Okay. So thank you all, and see you next week. Bye.
Thanks for having me. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.